Hello and welcome to the program. Hopefully you are staying safe and healthy, and the orders to stay at home that have been issued for the majority of North Texans have not put too much of a strain on you or your family during the corona crisis. Of course, I know a lot of families are struggling right now, and unfortunately, according to child advocates, children are more at risk for abuse and neglect during this time. As a matter of fact, last week, doctors at Cook Children's Hospital in Fort Worth said that they believe the stresses from the coronavirus pandemic were linked to 6 cases of severe child abuse seen at the hospital the week of March 16th. That's normally how many cases they see in a month. And the children, all under the age of 4. What can we do as a community to help these children who are at risk? Joining me on the phone right now is Kathleen Laval. She is the president and CEO of Dallas CASA, court-appointed special advocates. She is on the front lines when it comes to child abuse prevention and fighting for the rights of children to keep them safe. Kathleen, thank you so much for being on the program today.
Thank you for inviting me, Anna.
Does the increase in the number of child abuse cases during this time surprise you at all, Kathleen?
No, we were actually talking about it before the news broke about Cook Hospital, which was so devastating. You know, we just look back on 2008, 2009, the recession, the market crashing, and we saw the exact same pattern, a huge increase in the number of really serious child abuse cases that were seen during that time period because of the incredible stress and pressure that families are under. And aggravating that situation today and making it really more concerning is that our front line, our reporters, and I'm talking about the educators, our teachers, our counselors, our school nurses, are not in the same room with our kids. So with the schools closed, we have the real potential for not just more abuse to occur, but for less of that abuse to be reported.
People forget that teachers and school nurses, they're the ones that oftentimes see the signs, see a child retreating, or they see the bruises, and they're the ones that are able to report.
That's absolutely right. I mean, it will vary from year to year as to what is the top percentage of reporting category. Last year for statewide for Texas, we had 450,000 reports made, and more than 15% of those came from our schools. Medical was a little bit higher; it was close to 19%. That relationship trades back and forth year to year, and you know we prefer it to be our educators, because when the medical professionals are the ones doing the reporting, it's usually, as we saw in the recent news, it's usually those cases that are very severe.
You work with so many other agencies that are working to prevent child abuse here in North Texas. What should parents who are stressed out because of their job situation, because of what is going on with the coronavirus, the news that they're being bombarded with, who lose their patients, who may be quick to anger because of what is going on, what should they know on how to manage that anger so that the situation doesn't escalate to child abuse?
Well, I think one of the most important bits of advice we can give and encouragement we can give is, you know, if you're a couple, to recognize in one another the signs that stress is escalating, so you can try and break that circuit of stress, you know, before a child becomes the stress absorber and is harmed. So just recognizing in your partner and your spouse that they've reached the limits. It's just a really, really important skill and a form of intervention to recognize and to be able to give each other breaks as best you can. You know, such a shut down and isolated setting right now that it makes it much more difficult. You're not having the casual visits and you know, maybe the visits with grandparents are even, you know, less frequent than they otherwise might be. And so it really puts that responsibility on those in the household to be watchful. And also just to recognize when they themselves need support, to reach out. You know, we're doing an awful lot virtually these days. But it's still, you can have real meaningful human contact by phone, or we're using Zoom all the time now. It's free with the, you know, FaceTime. Yeah, but just to reach out and let somebody know that, you know, you're under stress, you're at some breaking point, so they can try and intervene.
And they can either call 211, the social services hotline, or they can Google for information on how to manage that stress so it doesn't escalate. Are there any agencies here in North Texas that they can reach out to that you know of?
Absolutely. Yes. I would definitely encourage folks to go onto the Mental Health America of Greater Dallas website. They have just great resources for helping you find support. And those are, you know, those are the agencies out there. But it's also important to recognize that there are other resources for those who are employed. And we have so many in our community now who are concerned about their employment status. But if you are employed, many companies have employee assistance programs that offer free services, free counseling sessions. Many of those are happening virtually through Zoom and Microsoft Teams and other great technologies. So, you know, this is a time to take advantage of those resources that are out there.
This is a very important time as well, Kathleen, to stay connected. If you have a loved one that you know is quick to anger, who has children, or if you have a friend who is in a situation where you worry about the children, stay connected with them by calling them, by texting them, and making sure that they're okay, kind of taking their temperature, if you will.
Absolutely, and letting them know that they can reach out. You know, I've just been surprised when I see the different ways that it may seem artificial at first, that folks are reaching out on social media platforms and whatever and saying, hey, remind me how we first met, or, you know, just that kind of casual connection that just opens the door to those human interactions. And so it's a great time to check in, particularly on, you know, families you know are under economic stress. If you're able to, you know, maybe even do something like have a restaurant deliver a meal. I mean, you just don't know what just one less dinner to cook, what that kind of gift could do in a stressful situation.
In a time of social distancing, how can we, as a community, protect children who are at risk?
Well, I think the most important thing is to remember that we have an abuse hotline. It's 800-252-5400. You know, when I look at who typically does the reporting of child abuse, the percentage of friends and neighbors is actually very low. It's about 3%, and that's going to have to change to protect our kids who are at home and in pressure cooker situations. So this is a time when, you know, if you see it, you really are going to have to say it. It's not a time where you can say to yourself, well, somebody else is going to intervene to protect a child. It's really a time when we have to recognize the stress on our parents, on households, and do our part to step up and make sure that our kids are protected.
1-800-252-5400. That's 1-800-252-5400. My guest once again on the phone is Kathleen Laval, the president and CEO of Dallas CASA, court-appointed special advocates, and she is on the front lines when it comes to child abuse prevention and fighting for the rights of children to keep them safe. As I mentioned at the top of the program, unfortunately, with this stress being placed on so many families here in North Texas because of the coronavirus pandemic, doctors across the Metroplex seeing an increase in the number of children that they are seeing in area hospitals who have been abused. So once again, that child abuse prevention hotline, 1-800-252-5400-5400. For someone who is not familiar with Dallas CASA court-appointed special advocates, Kathleen, how would you describe your work to protect children day in and day out?
Sure. What we do is we train and we support volunteer advocates who are assigned by our court system, our judges, to pending child welfare cases where a child has already been removed from home because they are a confirmed victim of child abuse or neglect. So our primary intervention is with children who are already living in the foster care system or other protective care placement. And what we do is we become that constant adult for that child to make sure that the judge hears what are the educational, therapeutic, medical services the child needs to recover from trauma. And then we all work toward, whenever possible, a reunification of the child with their family. And if that becomes impossible, it's not a safe option, then we help the court and the other stakeholders in the process identify loving, positive, permanent homes, forever homes, for our children to grow up safe and protected and be able to thrive. And so there's lots that the community can do right now if that's a cause that speaks to their heart.
We have court-appointed special advocates across the state. How did CASA come about?
It's a great history, and we're actually in our 40th year, so we have a lot of history to tell. We were one of the first of three pilot CASA programs nationwide that emulated a program that was started in Seattle, Washington, where a judge became very frustrated that he'd hear the same recommendations in CPS case after CPS case about what services the parents should undertake, you know, what classes they should take, and what interventions they should seek, and heard the same recommendations about how to be helpful to our children. And so he reached out to the community and says, I need you to be my eyes and ears. I need to be able to see this child literally through your testimony and your report. So a CASA volunteer is in essence a witness for the court to help them make the very, very best decisions they can about outcomes for our kids in the foster care system.
And this is because the other agencies are dealing with so much, whether it's the legal issues or whether it's the court system, but the court-appointed special advocate is focused strictly on the child.
Well, absolutely, and we just have a difference in bandwidth, right? Because our volunteers are assigned one case at a time, and that case can be a single child or a group of siblings, whereas, you know, a CPS caseworker has a much larger docket, landscape to deal with, as do our attorneys all of the other stakeholders in that process. So we have an ability to focus and to make that personal connection and really kind of stand in for the community as a standard bearer, a conscience of showing, you know, what would the community want? What's in the best interest of this child? What would you want if this were your child? And that's a different, I think, focus, you know, really unique to the system.
How is CASA dealing with the social distancing and the stay-at-home aspect right now when it comes to the children that the court-appointed special advocate is working with, Kathleen?
It's a challenge, but it's manageable, and it's working. That's what I'm so excited about. When we first had to announce that we were suspending face-to-face visits with children and families in foster care placements and relative placements and in homes where children have been returned but are still being monitored, it was heartbreaking, honestly. Because we stress so much that personal connection. And our advocates are so amazing. We've come up with kind of a guide to how to do a virtual visit with a child. It's on our website, DallasCASA.org, and I hope folks will go look at it. It's in the blog section. Even if you're a grandparent trying to figure out how to maintain contact with your grandkids while everyone is trying to protect your health and is maintaining that distance. But it's just so important that a child and the family or the foster family that they're living with feel that we're still here. You know, we're still here. We're going to be that constant. There's so many adults in a child welfare case who cycle in and out because it's designed that way. You start out with an investigation caseworker, and then it moves to a conservatorship caseworker, and then you might be working with an adoption unit. So it's intended to have specialists at each of those stages. But it's so important to have that one constant who a child looks forward to, anticipates seeing, and who the child just knows will show up when they say they will show up. And so now we're showing up, but we're doing it through Zoom and FaceTime and Skype and every other technology that's useful out there, and just come up with, I think, some really creative ways to have, for example, to have a child take you on a tour. Let them, you know, show you what the toys are they're playing with now. What are they learning? What are they most excited about?
And this is also very important for the CASA volunteer to talk to the child if they're stressed, because this is a very stressful time, not just for adults, but very much so for children.
Well, absolutely. And I shared a quote with my staff this morning. I send out morning messages, and this one had a John F. Kennedy quote in it about the Chinese word for crisis. It can mean both danger and opportunity. And the opportunity right now, if someone is interested in becoming an advocate, a volunteer advocate in our program or any of the 72 CASA programs in Texas, I think we're all figuring out ways to keep the process of recruitment and training going. If you go on our website, you'll find we have information sessions still ongoing. Well, we're actually conducting those using Zoom. So we're excited that we're still getting inquiries, because it's an amazing community, and particularly because you may have a little bit more downtime, and this may be a fabulous time to check in on a one-hour info session to learn more about the role of a CASA volunteer, and then our training itself is actually converting to be almost entirely online content during this crisis.
And that's DallasCASA.org if you want more information about becoming a CASA volunteer or how you can help in the fight against child abuse here in our area. Obviously, with what is going on and hospitals seeing an increase in the number of child abuse cases that they're seeing, do you think you're going to need more CASA volunteers in the aftermath of this crisis?
We absolutely will, and it's a pattern we see not just when there's a pandemic. We see an increase in the number of children needing to be removed from home when the school year starts, for example. That's, again, when our educators are once again able to lay eyes on our children and see those signs. And so we expect when the curtain lifts and this crisis is behind us, that we will see an increase, and we'll need everyone with us doing our best to be that voice for children so that our judges can make the absolute best decisions possible.
It is the last Sunday of March. The month of April is Child Abuse Prevention Month, an annual observance dedicated to raising awareness and preventing child abuse. According to national statistics, every 10 seconds in the United States, there is a report of child abuse. And as I mentioned earlier, here in North Texas right now, there's been a spike in cases of abuse because of the coronavirus pandemic. My guest on the phone, Kathleen Laval, the president and CEO of Dallas CASA, court-appointed special advocates. She is on the front lines when it comes to child abuse prevention and fighting for the rights of children to keep them safe. Who can become a CASA volunteer, Kathleen? For someone who's listening, who heard the news last week about the spike in the number of child abuse cases and says, I want to do something. I want to make a difference in the community. Who can become an advocate?
Well, first of all, you need to be 21 years old or older. We are incredibly fortunate in the Dallas community that we have our volunteer advocates are spread across age demographics. It's just amazing. We have as many 30-year-olds as we do 60 and above. And so it's, it can be the right time in anyone's life to explore this extraordinary opportunity to make a huge impact. There's an application process. It starts with attending an info session, information session, to learn about the role, to ask your questions, to make sure it's going to be a good fit. And then there's a personal interview, which we are also now conducting using Zoom. And then we have we have eight classes. Normally we have eight in-person classes, and as I mentioned, we'll be converting those to online e-learning platform, because we really can't afford to slow down this process of recruiting and enlisting volunteers. And the most important message, if you're interested in becoming a volunteer advocate, is to know that you're paired with a professional program supervisor. So we may put you through 8 classes of training, but that's boot camp. Your real experience will come on the job, and that happens with the support and the guidance of a trained program supervisor. So you will never feel like you're in this on your own.
When it comes to volunteering, a lot of times people say, well, I don't know if I have the time. So how much of a time commitment are we talking for being a CASA volunteer?
Well, I'll start by saying that, you know, over 85% of our volunteer advocates are full-time employed. So this is definitely a manageable volunteer role, but it is a serious commitment in the early month of the appointment, because if they have like a CPS history, you may be going to the CPS office and looking at files. You know, you really could expect as much as 15 to 20 hours that month might be dedicated to that case. We hear from our volunteer advocates that, you know, it drops off the majority of the months. It's going to be something closer, you know, to 10 hours. Most cases last less than 18 months. We ask our volunteers to commit to a year or conclusion of that case. And we are very, very fortunate that so many of our volunteer advocates, not only do they stay till the conclusion of the case, but they line up to get that next case. And so I think just realizing in such an immediate way what a profound difference you can make in the life of a child. I mean, you really can be that individual who, by showing love and concern, enables that child to learn what a reliable adult looks like, to learn about healthy, trusting attachments, and to really just see you as an example of what the grown-up world can look like.
And your volunteers come from all walks of life, men and women, and they don't have to have a legal background.
That is so critical. I am so glad you mentioned that, Anna, because that's a common misconception. Not only do you not need a legal background, but you don't need to know anything about social services or the child welfare system itself. I love it when I welcome our training classes and I look around, and these are not individuals whose kids all go to the same school or who worship in the same faith communities or who have, anywhere near similar experiences and background. We just have a rich, rich collection, and we always need a deeper bench. So if it sounds at all like something that would speak to you and just give you that sense of purpose and meaning, we really hope you'll come to an info session.
DallasCASA.org if you want more information about that, about the info sessions, the training, DallasCASA.org. Besides the time commitment, some may say, I don't think I could be a CASA volunteer because it would break my heart to see children who've been abused. What do you say to them?
That it will break your heart to know it's happening and not be able to do anything. What I always tell our volunteer recruits is that this is a position that is all about looking forward. You're not the investigator in the case. That's been done. And it is very forward-looking, very solutions-focused. And so what you're looking for is how do I help this child? How do I restore that sense of hope, that promise? How do I help this child not be defined by having lived in foster care? How do I help them really expand what they imagine is the opportunity, their potential, the person they can become? And that is so affirming and so positive. So I think if you talk to a CASA volunteer, I mean, some of them tell you they figured out they were born to do this, which, you know, just gives me goosebumps. And most say, I didn't have any idea if I had the skills, you know, to the skill set to do this. And then I got in there and I realized I could make a difference sometimes by doing something that the larger world would consider very insignificant. You know, I helped get another copy of a birth certificate or of a shot record or vaccines, and that's what got the child into preschool, and it made a difference, and it helped the relative who was taking care of the child. So there are just so many ways that you can intervene and feel like you've made just such a positive difference.
I know on the website, Kathleen, at DallasCasa.org, you have a lot of inspiring stories about the impact that CASA volunteers make. Is there any one story out of the thousands that come through your doors that's just really hit close to home for you, where you say, this is why we do what we do?
Can I tell two?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I have to tell you one because it just happened last night. And it's not in the kind of traditional model of a CASA volunteer, but I had one of our amazing volunteers reach out to me and say that her employer had access to a supply of surgical masks, and she knew that our CPS investigators, who are really on the front line and physically responding to allegations of abuse, and their role is so, so critical. She reached out and asked, you know, did I think the CPS caseworkers, you know, would benefit from access to this supply? I reached out to the regional director of CPI, the investigations department for our region, which is Dallas and the outlying counties east of I-35. She responded instantly, and so 100 surgical masks are going to be on their way to the CPS building on Stebbins Freeway. So I'm just super excited about that. So if you want to hear a more traditional, not in the middle of a crisis story, I think, you know, my favorite always has been a volunteer, Suzanne, who had been assigned to a 4- and 5-year-old brother and sister. They came into care because of a drug addiction problem that their mom struggled with, and they were able to live with their grandmother, and the case closed with kind of legal guardianship with the grandmother. Just not, you know, several months later, she encountered a health problem and wasn't able to care for the kids. So they came into care again, only this time went into foster care, you know, a home, you know, where they knew no one. It was completely unfamiliar. And Suzanne agreed to be assigned again, went out to visit the first time. A 5-year-old boy, you know, seizures, he's walking up, you know, the sidewalk, runs out, does that kind of hallmark moment, you know, leaping into her arms. And he just said to her, you know, how did you find us? Oh. You know, we didn't think anyone knew where we were. And that, I mean, I think that just really goes to the heart of it, that a child could feel so forgotten.
Yeah.
You know, just disconnected, that they would think they literally were on no one's radar screen, no one's mind, you know, in no one's heart. And yet, you know, from that connection between Suzanne and those two kids, you know, they had a way of feeling a sense of belonging, that deep sense of someone cares for me.
They had that person, that volunteer who was going to be there for them. Well, during this time, as we see an increase in the number of child abuse cases in North Texas as a result of the stress brought on by the coronavirus pandemic, I say, if you see something, say something, call the Child Abuse Prevention Hotline, 800-252-5400. If you want to do more, become a court-appointed special advocate for children in need, DallasCasa.org. Kathleen, thank you so much for being on the program.
Anna, you're so terrific to bring all these issues to light. I really, really appreciate you.
Thank you.